So for anyone who's not here and they're maybe wondering if there's anything happening, I'll go on to my first slide, which is an agenda slide, and these are the things we're going to talk about in the next few minutes. I do always like to clarify what my assumptions are. I see Jamie's got his audio going great. Well done. I'll clarify what my assumptions are. I'll tell you what my objectives are for the next few minutes. I actually have something I want to get out of this, believe it or not. And before we get into the top five leadership characteristics, which is the majority of my talk, I just want to clarify a little bit about some definitions around leadership and the two different leadership types I like to talk about. And I always end every session, if you've been in any of my sessions at some of our events lately, last few years, you'll know I always end, and I always encourage all of my co-workers at Pink Elephant to end with some recommended next steps. I want to make sure that you go away with something that's going to be useful to you, something that you can follow up and do something with. My job is not just to keep you engaged and entertained for the next hour or so. It's actually to give you something you can take away and use. And so I'll remind you at the end of the major learning points and the actions you can take to follow up. So stick with me right through to the end. So here's a little bit on my assumptions. I'm pretty sure most people here are working in service management. You probably have some responsibilities for some kind of assets, whether it's actually data or people or software or services. You've got some responsibilities. We all have that. And if you're like the 99.99999% of the population in the world, when you go to work every day, you want to feel satisfied. You want to make sure that there's some satisfaction to you, not just enjoying the work, but you want the work to be perceived as valuable, to be actually valuable to your organization. So you want your business to be successful. There's a little bit more, actually. People, behavioral psychologists tell us that people want to be helpful to coworkers. They want to enjoy the work. They want to get some fulfillment from it. And they want their organization to be successful. I mean, some of this is very obvious. If you're working in an unsuccessful organization, the prospects for the future are not great. So, you know, everyone has this positive outlook about what they want to do and how they contribute at work. So, I'm going to try to give you some advice for how you can be more productive at work and enjoy your work more and help your coworkers and help the business. So that's what I'm assuming you want to learn. My specific goals are, I'm only going to be happy myself in my work if you are getting something of value. I have to inspire you to do something different, to change your behavior. Just giving you some information, some facts, some figures, some ideas isn't enough. I need to inspire you with that new knowledge to do things differently and hopefully achieve better results. In fact, I use, and some of you might have heard me talk about this before, I use the teachings of a management guru or an adult learning guru from the 50s and 60s, a guy called Donald Kirkpatrick. You know, if you've got another window open and you want to Google Kirkpatrick, Kirkpatrick talked about how we evaluate the effectiveness of training. And of course, in our business at Pink, where this is very close to our hearts, you know, we not only do we want to be in business and pay the bills, but we want to be doing something of value that our customers find useful and helpful. And a way to justify investment in training surely is to show that the training has delivered some results. And Kirkpatrick talked about a very simple model of four ways to evaluate training. The first is something we're all very familiar with, which is when you sit in a class or a presentation, at the end, you often get a piece of paper handed to you where you have to check boxes or give a rating and say, yeah, I enjoyed this. You know, I'll give it 8 out of 10 or 7 out of 10 or I didn't enjoy it, 2 out of 10. Or, you know, you circle a happy smiley face or something. That level of effectiveness measuring, if you like, Kirkpatrick said, this is just evaluating your reaction to the experience. your personal subjective reaction. And most people in the training or the presentation business do something like this. It's the least we can do. But it doesn't prove that you've walked away with any new knowledge. Walking away with new knowledge means level two in the Kirkpatrick scale. And the only way we can validate that is some form of testing. So that's why in a lot of business training courses, you get some examination or some certification out. And that's the level two that Kirkpatrick talks about, validating that you've learned something. So you walked into the session with a bit of an empty compartment in part of your brain, and you've walked out with some data stored in there, which is some information you've learned. But it still doesn't prove that you're going to do anything with it. Now, we can test your capability to learn in a class or even in a session like this. And by the way, I'm not going to give you a test at the end of this session. But I could ask you if you learn all of the things I'm going to talk about, and you could do a little cute quiz or a little test at the end, and that would prove you've learned something or would give an indication you've learned something new. But what Kirkpatrick wants us to do is to somehow measure and track the change behavior back at work, that you're actually doing some of the things that you normally would do differently. You're now doing them in a better way because of the new knowledge being useful to you. And that's the third level on the Kirkpatrick scale. Did you change behavior? So if you're on an ITIL class, for example, and we teach you how a change management system could work, you may go back to work and you have some documents you're going to update. You're going to complete fields and forms and screens differently. You're going to engage with coworkers about planning for changes, using some consistent terminology, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You're changing your behavior. Now, that sounds good, and it's better than just evaluating your reaction and evaluating whether you learned something new. Applying the new knowledge at level three on the Kirkpatrick scale is a good thing, right? But it still doesn't prove that your business is any better off. And so the fourth level on the Kirkpatrick scale is, over time, has your business, your team, your department, your business benefited from what you've learned? And that's really tough for us or for me to verify with you. The only way I can do that is to come and see you or talk to you, or probably not even you, but your coworkers or your boss, a few weeks from now and say, look, you know, I talked about leadership. I gave some recommendations for this, this, and this. Did she or did he do this? Are they doing it now? And do you act? That's the change behavior at level three. And are you seeing better results? Are people more productive? Are they more motivated? Are we actually eliminating a lot of the challenges and problems we had, and we're being more efficient and we're delivering better results for the business? That's the fourth level. So my goal really is to try and drive you or inspire you to that fourth level. So I always try to encourage people to think about what they want out of a session like this, or a training course if we send someone along to teach your team about, you know, new ways of doing things and best practices. Think in advance about what improved results you want to see. And then after whatever is a reasonable time, see if that comes to reality, comes to fruition. Then we can show that the whole experience has been worthwhile. So as you know, I'm not going to come knocking on your door in a few weeks' time asking if the things I talk about today have been applied. But I'd like you to think about this, not just for today's session, but everything you ever do in the future, where you sit and listen to some so-called expert or some teacher, or where you send someone on a training course. What is it you want to get out of it? Otherwise, it's just a happy experience, and all we do is check some boxes at the level one on Kirkpatrick scale. Okay, that's enough about adult learning for me now. I'm going to get back to my topic of leadership. When we think of leadership, usually we think of these things. I'm not going to read all my bullets on my slides. I've got a few charts and diagrams and pictures and photographs and things like that. But where I have bullets, I don't usually read them all. You can read them yourself there. This is what we usually think of when we think of leaders, right? We think of people who are, you know, the boss or the person in charge or who's responsible for the important things. And I'm going to give you some examples when I get into my five important leadership characteristics. I'm going to call up some examples of great leaders, either contemporary leaders from business today or other leaders from history that we're probably all familiar with. And I'll throw in a few quotations and a few experiences or things we've learned about those leaders. If you actually go on YouTube, not right now, but afterwards, you and kind of do a search on some of the keywords of what we're talking about today, you will find a video that I loaded up a while back where I actually go through 24 leadership characteristics. I picked the top five today, and I give examples in this video of each of those characteristics and an example of a leader from history or contemporary in business or in the contemporary world who illustrates each of those characteristics. So, you can find that quite easily if you go to the Pink Elephant YouTube channel. Don't do it right now. Do not do it right now, please. Do it later, okay? Right, so this is what we mean by leadership. But when leadership's not good and something's wrong, this is what we see. People don't know what they're supposed to be doing. I'm going to break my rule and read these now. They don't know why they should be doing it. They don't know how to go about it. They don't know who's really responsible, blah, blah, blah. They don't know the who, what, why, where, whens of what they're supposed to be doing. In fact, this has been evidenced from a survey done a few years ago of 2,000 line managers who were asked, when your team or when your staff don't perform well, what's the reason for this? Why don't they perform? And the number one reason managers gave for why people don't perform is they don't know what they're supposed to be doing. So the manager's gone along and found people are working on the wrong things. Well, who do you think's responsible for that? It's not just the individual. It's the leader, right? The manager. I'm using the words leader and manager interchangeably right now, but I'm going to qualify them in a minute because they are different. But let's just leave that for now. So when people don't perform well, it isn't just an indictment of the individual underperforming. It also shows that we have a leadership problem. So I'm going to try to give you some ideas today about how to improve your ability to lead. Now, right now, I want to make it clear that if you're not someone who has anyone reporting to you, so you're working not in isolation, hopefully, you have co-workers, you have a boss, you have other people you relate to, but if you don't have someone reporting to you, you may think you don't need to demonstrate leadership, but I'm going to show you how that's not the case. Every single one of us not only has the opportunity, but has really a responsibility to demonstrate leadership, and specifically the five characteristics I talk about. In fact, the complete list of 24 characteristics I mentioned earlier, every one of us can demonstrate all of those. And there's only one small part of one of those characteristics that's dependent on you being the boss of someone. I'll get to that in a few minutes. So there are actually two types of leader. This is the same slide you saw a few minutes ago, but I've got on the bottom here, there are two types of leader. And I just want to mention those two types now before we get into the five characteristics. Look at this chart here. You see the titles in red? They are what we call the designated leaders. They're the designated leaders. Hopefully you can see why. I call them the designated leaders because they've probably in this scenario or this org chart, they've been appointed, hired specially for their capabilities in that position or promoted into it. So they've been selected, they've been hired or promoted to do those jobs in red. And the people who are in the dark blue or not red, those are not designated leaders of others, because you can see they don't have anyone reporting to them. You can still have a manager title. See, we've got one or two managers there who are not designated leaders of people. But I think this is a bit of an old-fashioned model and isn't particularly helpful, certainly for my discussion today, because I think leadership applies right across the board to all of these people. And I use the term self-empowered leadership. Every single person can demonstrate leadership qualities and can empower themselves to do that. And that's what I'm going to talk about today. When I get into the five qualities, which is what comes up next, five characteristics, I'm going to give examples of whether you're in a designated leader role where you explicitly have people who are looking to you for leadership, or whether you're in a self-empowered role, which includes additionally people who are not responsible for others. The characteristics I'm going to refer to, I'm going to describe the context in both of those scenarios. And when I get to the end and I give you my next steps recommendations, I'll try to pass them out and say, look, if you're in a designated leadership role, I'd like you to do this, this, and this. And if you're in a self-empowered leadership role, maybe you can modify those actions slightly this way and that way. Okay. So what do I mean when I talk about leadership and management? This is not just me. As you can see at the bottom, I've got this kind of chart or this kind of like parallel list of responsibilities or expectations we see from managers and from leaders. And you'll see this in various academic locations and in books, etc. But managers are preoccupied with the present. It's today's operations and tactics. They have plans that they're working to, that they're guiding their people and themselves towards. They like to work with process, or they need to work with processes and activities. There's very much, if we're well organized, we've got clear expectations around objectives and measurements. There are administrative tasks that need to be completed, you know, day to day, sometimes hour by hour. Very working in a context of systems and structure and controls, have a relatively narrow focus on the tasks at hand and the responsibilities for their team or their department. The things they're preoccupied with are how do we get things done and when do we have to get it done by? So kind of short time horizons and narrow focus. Now, don't take any of that as negative. These requirements are absolutely essential if we're to deliver value in any activity, in any type of business. We need managers who can perform the things I've just said very, very well. There's no shame. It's not a limiting factor. If you can do these things really well, you'll go far and you'll be well respected and you'll feel fulfilled, and it's good. So, you know, if you're a service desk manager, the types of things I've listed in here, you can think about them in the service desk context. And if you're a good service desk manager, well respected, it's because you do these things well. Now, our leaders tend to have a wider field of view and a longer thinking horizon. They're thinking more about what needs to happen next, the future. They have this vision. They're thinking about something around, you know, the things about improvement or how we need to change. They're guided a lot by their values and the values of the organization, which are the things that are important to you. They're much more preoccupied with thinking about the current context in terms of attitudes and behaviors of the people in their team and that they work with and that they interact with. They are people. Just like managers are too, but they're more thinking about the people than the administrative and the process side of things. They have to be respected, otherwise their ability to lead is going to be compromised. We'll see that in a few minutes. They have, as I said, a wide area of focus. They connect dots. They see the implications of things. So they're always asking about what do we need to do and why do we need to do it? This is important. We need good leaders. In fact, we need people who can manage and who can lead. In fact, when we have managers, managers often have a requirement, as I said, with the designated leader. We often expect our managers to also be leaders. But there's the rub. There's the problem. Sometimes someone can be an excellent manager, but they're not necessarily a great leader. We'll look at some of the characteristics in a moment, and you'll start to relate to this. On the other side, you can actually have people who are great leaders but aren't good at the day-to-day management of getting things done. and maybe the interactions with people aren't great. You know, you can try to think of people in your experience that you've worked with who you'd say, that was an excellent manager I worked with, but you know, when it came to leadership, they didn't think a lot about the long-term future. They relied on their boss to be their leader and really our leader. You might have experience of people who demonstrate some of these characteristics, qualities, and capabilities around leadership, but weren't good managers. I certainly can. I can think of both examples, and in fact, I can even think right here at Pink where I work now. I know where my strengths lie here, and I know where the strengths of my coworkers and the people I depend on lie in either one column or the other. It's a very special person who's exceptional in both of these columns. But anyway, this is just a little discussion around the difference between management and leadership, and we are talking about leadership from now on. So, you know, I've mentioned, you know, what leadership is in the designated context and in the self-empowered context. In both of those, this is what we look for in a leader. Somebody who understands and can describe the vision, and they're good at communicating that so that others understand and buy in. Then they are able to empower the people around them, empower them with knowledge and information and methods and tools to get the vision realized. So that's a function of leadership, is empowering people. And then being able, especially in today's fast-paced world, I know that's a bit of a cliche, but in today's world, we've also got to be able to balance all the conflicting priorities and interests of others, and you know, be a diplomat and also be a thinker to connect dots together and see that, you know, our vision that we were working on recently needs to maybe be rethought and repositioned, and how does it affect the new pressures that, and the new constraints that we're working with today. So, you know, we're always looking at a continual improvement, but today, you know, the planning horizons are much shorter than they used to be, and we have to be prepared to be agile and to be flexible and change when necessary. And a leader can identify those moments in time. So sure enough, a leader does step up at times in crisis and comes up with creative solutions. But I'm going to try to suggest to you that that's not necessarily the most valuable characteristics for leaders. Some of them are able to do that, but if you can do a lot of the other things that we expect of leaders well, you can still be an exceptional leader without being the one coming up with the creative ideas and solutions and stepping up in times of crisis. So I've mentioned more than once these 24 characteristics. Here's the definitive list. I'm saying definitive. This is just my idea here. I put these in like a cloud. It's just a way that, it's a different way to present them instead of a simple list. It's a little bit more colorful and everything. But these all kind of fit into skills and knowledge and attitudes and behaviors. And maybe that's something I'll talk about at length on another day, about how we need leaders to have certain knowledge and skills, like business awareness, the ability to communicate is a skill, but we also want to see certain behaviors and certain attitudes, you know, around honesty, around confidence and inspiration, etc. So these are a couple of dozen characteristics on my full day leadership masterclass. We go through these all in more detail. But, you know, I often get asked, you know, which is the most important, or which is the most critical, or which is, what is it you've got to get right, or what's the most important? What comes first, for example? And it's really almost impossible to answer that question, but I do put some thought into it, and I've come up with five that I think are worth talking about and calling out. And, you know, even within that five, I might be bold enough before we finish to say which one is the one I think is the most important. But, you know, there's so many dependencies. You know, you could be good at this and great at this, but if you're missing this other characteristic, this other capability, then, you know, maybe you've got an incomplete profile here. So it starts to get tricky when you just say, as long as you're great at this, you can be a good leader. Well, you've got to be great at this plus some of the other things as well, mainly around attitudes and behaviors. So what are my five? Well, here are my five characteristics. I use the word vision, but I'm very, very careful not to say creates a vision. To me, it's more important that our leaders understand there is a vision, relate to it, identify with it, buy into it. So if it was be responsible for the creation of a vision, then that requires us to also have other characteristics as strengths, like being able to think deeply and creatively and differently, to be creative. Now, it's great if you can do that stuff, but the creation of a vision now starts to only be relevant to the designated leader. And I want these characteristics to be relevant to everybody, whether you're the designated leader with the responsibility for the vision, or you're a self-empowered leader who understands the vision and reminds and socializes our vision with your coworkers, your partners in terms of suppliers, people you work with, either subordinates or even your superiors. So we'll talk about that in a moment. Number two is more about attitude and behavior. And we'll talk about some of the characteristics which allow you to be positioned as a person that's respected. If you're not a respected person, why is that? I'll explain that in a second. This is really a prerequisite to good leadership. No one's going to follow a leader they don't respect. Number three, describing a workable approach, and I've underscored the letter A because I want to talk about being decisive and decision-making and making choices around options. And one of the symptoms we have in business today is we procrastinate. We're always looking for perfect solutions before we make decisions and proceed. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that. So a good leader is decisive and chooses paths for action, which will be workable and which will deliver relevant results. Number four is, I'm going to explain what I mean by empowering, how you empower yourself and others, and how you inspire others in action. Again, you don't have to be the designated leader. You can be a self-empowered leader working with coworkers, and you can empower them. This is the one area where there's one aspect of empowerment which only applies to designated leaders, and I'll make a point of calling that out. And number five, if I had to say what is the number one most important thing of a leader, after a glass of wine, I might be tempted to say it's the ability to communicate, but it's still not something that can stand alone. If you're great at everything else and you're not able to communicate, then you're probably not leading. You might be a deep, smart, intelligent thinker who understands what's relevant, what should be done. You may well be able to work and help your coworkers, but if you're not communicating effectively, yeah, there's something missing. And you're probably not going to be respected as a leader if your communication skills are lacking. However, if all you bring to the table is excellent communication skills, you're more likely to be regarded as a busybody troublemaker. And imagine if you've got the wrong ideas and you're not somebody who's respected, but you are able to get messages across, but they're not messages people trust. See how communicating on its own is not going to be good enough. You do need a raft or a collection of complementary characteristics to be effective as a leader. So who can we think of as good leaders who identified with a vision? Well, have a look at this. Remember who this gentleman was? I'm sure most people do. Thinking about the future. I don't know enough about the day-to-day operation of the civil rights movement in the 60s, to be honest with you, to say whether or not Martin Luther King was elected or appointed into a position. I should find that out. But to me, he may well be, when I think of him as just somebody who stood up and spoke as a great communicator, but was also a deep thinker, and may well be a self-empowered leader, somebody who just came to the fore. It may well be that in some of the groups that he was a member of, he was elected, and that's how he got his position of leadership. Doesn't matter anyway, whether it's that way or the other way. This is an example of a leader who clarified a vision for the future. Here's another one from a completely different aspect of everyday life. Walt Disney had this fantastic vision, even well before building Disney World in Florida, of course. If you read anything about the world of Disney in the 30s, you know, went out on a limb with a vision for a feature-length animated movie. Everybody thought the guy was nuts. You know, Snow White, you know, a 75-minute or 80-minute movie, nobody's going to sit patiently and watch that in the movie theater. Guess what? Our kids and grandkids are still watching that today. He had this vision for the future of how he could reinvent family entertainment. And some of his quotes are very famous, but there's a visionary guy. Now, both of these people, Martin Luther King and Walt Disney, I call out as being excellent examples of leaders who demonstrate the quality of visioning, the ability to create a vision and communicate it, identify with it, remind everyone. In fact, Walt Disney's brother, I think it's his brother, Roy Disney, actually said, there's a quote I remember reading from him, he said that your vision, if you remind yourself of your vision, and I'm paraphrasing, it guides all of your decisions. And if you're unsure about what to do, just remind yourself of what your vision is or your vision statement, and it will guide you and it will make your decisions easier. That's very true. So in IT service management, I'd like you to think from a vision perspective about what type of organization are you trying to be? What do I mean by that? Have you got ambitious goals in your organization to really genuinely lead the business and provide opportunities? Or is your vision for ITSM to allow the business, the strength enough in the business elsewhere, to provide the vision for the future for the business, and IT service management is just to try to keep in lockstep and try to be responsive and try to be there on the shoulder of the business, delivering services that the business determines it needs. I think there's an opportunity even in many organizations today where you can be more creative in providing the business with opportunities that it doesn't know it needs or it can exploit right now. I'll give you some examples in a minute or two, so don't worry, this isn't just all theory. Now, the vision is supported by a mission. Vision is the kind of happy state we're heading towards, that place on the horizon there, that shining kind of vision for the future on the horizon. The mission is how you're going to get there. What's the strategy you're going to apply? What's the approach you're going to take? What specific actions and organization responsibilities and structure do you need to put in place to realize the vision? And then the objectives are the specific measurable things that you're going to define that will show that you're achieving your vision and mission. So there's a relationship here between vision as being the ultimate purpose for why you exist, the mission for how you go about realizing that, and the goals or objectives for how you know you're on track and you're achieving that. So, you know, the purpose of ITSM really is thinking about what do we do to support our business? You know, where are we headed? What's the kind of time scales? How are we going to do that through our mission? And validating the purpose of ITSM and our mission by explaining the implications of failure as well as the implications of success. This helps you with the why. So I like to talk about relevancy, and I'll talk about this a little bit more in a few minutes, but making sure that what you do is relevant to the business and really delivering valuable results. So our actions and our objectives need to be clearly understood by everyone. So if you're the leader or you are a self-empowered leader trying to empower and help your coworkers as well as clarify your own role and responsibilities, make sure everybody understands where we're headed, how we're going to get and why, how are we going to get there, what specific actions backed up with measurable objectives will prove to us that we're on that track. And then we're going to be decisive and make things happen. So here's a little summary of what I mean by vision, mission, and goal. Goals and objectives, the same kind of word is synonymous to me, goals, objectives. What do you want your service management organization to look like? And I'm going to give you some guidance if you're not sure about how to describe that. How are you going to realize that vision, and what are those specific objectives? Now, here's a little bit of insight into how we use this at Pink, not just in our service management area, but in our business generally. This is our vision. Our vision is we want to be perceived, we want to be recognized as the leader in IT service management best practices. Since we started this whole thing off years ago, this is what we said we wanted to be. We want to be the place people come to when they need knowledge and support and guidance and best practices within ITSM. How do we do this? What's our mission? How do we break that down? So the vision's kind of never ending. It goes on forever. Yeah, you can change your vision, but you're really changing the purpose of your organization if you change the vision. And your mission would therefore have to change as well. But our mission could change over time, and I'll tell you how in these four bullet points. Over the last 20 years, we've had the same vision, but our mission has evolved. How we go about doing realizing our vision has evolved. So we enable that vision by doing research and documenting what those best practices are. And we do that through something we call Pink Online, which is our online database, Pink Atlas and Pink Scan. And this isn't meant to be a sales pitch, by the way. I'm just trying to explain to you how we use vision, mission, and objectives. So we write everything down. This is what we mean by best practices, and this is how we access them, and this is how we use them. We promote them in our events like this. We deliver them in our education programs, and we actually work with them and practice them when we come and do consulting work for you or other customers. So that's our mission. Those are our service lines, the bold stuff, the online service line, the conferences service line, the education and the consulting. That's what Pink does, all in the area of service management for IT. Now, we do have objectives. And by the way, that mission with those specific elements of the mission have been there for years, but our online business wasn't there at the beginning. We really researched and documented those best practices, and we kept them to ourselves, not kept them to ourselves. We had them stored here in folders on laptops and in computers here in our office, but we didn't really make them available to anyone because this was kind of like in the early days of the web many years ago. We didn't have an online service with what we call Pink Atlas and Pink Scan, Pink Ready, and other tools that we have. So that there is a real-life example of how our mission has evolved as technology and the expectations of our customers and demands of our customers have changed. Every time we ever showed up at a customer site 20 years ago with our ring binders full of documented best practices that we try to educate and practice on a customer engagement, our customers would say, you know, how can we get access to this? And so guess what? About 12 years ago, we started to create an online database and make that available to you, our customers. So our vision was the same, but how we go about realizing that vision started to evolve. And of course, the types of conferences, the types of education, the types of consulting have all evolved as well. I would like to think improved. So what do we mean by objectives? Well, we have specific objectives, and because we're a private company at Pink, we keep these objectives close to our our chest. If you talk to anybody who works at Pink, they could tell you what our objectives are this year. They're usually around things like targets for growth, you know, market share, specific major service lines or products that we want to launch, making sure we're solvent and we're, you know, profitable and we're surviving and paying the bills. So we have specific objectives which are much more time sensitive in terms of, you know, annual objectives translated into monthly objectives and even maybe weekly and daily objectives which support those. So your objectives in IT service management should be relevant to the mission, which is relevant to the vision. And those objectives will change fairly frequently over time. As your business grows, as the requirements and demands from the business change, your objectives will change. And so I always like to ask people, and if you've been in any of my sessions in the last year or two, you have heard me ask this question, and you're all fortunate right now because we're on a webinar. We're not actually in a classroom or in a conference room all together where I can look you in the eye and kind of ask you directly to share this, your answer with everyone. But I ask you this in a rhetorical way. Do you know what your team's objectives are right now? Do you know what your department objectives are? Do you know what your business objectives are this year? If you're a public company, this should be freely available, not just to you, but to anyone. If you're a private company, there's no reason anyone outside of your business has a right to know your objectives. Just like I've said, Pink's objectives are special, and we keep them to ourselves because that's knowledge that could help our competitors, for example. But certainly working within the business, you should really know what you're striving to do. So one of my pieces of advice for you is to go away and find out, first of all, can you confirm your business's vision and the mission for how we're going about doing the work that we do in our greater business? And what are the business objectives? Because I'm telling you, they will guide you. When you are trying to make decisions in IT every day about what to focus on, what to prioritize, what to put at the top of your to-do list, what can be left till next week or next month or can be postponed for a while you work on something else, the business objectives will guide you. If you want to find out examples of vision, mission, and objectives for other IT service management organizations, you can do that. Go browse the internet, do it afterwards, go on Google or something, or whatever your search engine is, and just key those words in. I did it, and I got tons. I just want to show you one quick example here. You know, I don't need to read it. It's just, you can see that's just a screen capture. Just type in vision mission for ITSM, and you'll start to get, and you'll be able to say, oh, there's a utility organization. Oh, there's an insurance company. Oh, there's a government department. So whatever business you're in, you'll be able to find something similar. Now, I will admit, they're not all great examples. So, you know, you might want to read up a little bit more, which is one of my recommendations, on understanding the purpose of vision, mission, and objectives, and that will help you to evaluate good examples. Guess what? In IT service management, whether you're in an insurance company or a bank or a retail business or a government department, your service management operation is pretty similar from one organization to another. There's not a huge variation in differences, but you know what? Make it relevant, make it memorable, make it easy to understand and explain to people, and then you'll get the attention and you'll get the cooperation of your coworkers. Okay, that's vision and mission. Generating respect, guess what this is all about? This is about creating trust, creating credibility. There's a whole bunch of things here. You know, Walter Cronkite was famous for, you know, being the person in the U.S. everyone looked to and trusted for the news. You know, if you look at somebody present day, here's values. Values, this is what Ellen says her values are. Have you got value statements for yourself? Do you think about what your organization values are? They might have been communicated to you. You probably haven't defined or written down values for your team or department. Some of you might have. It's kind of a useful idea. Values are just the things that are important to you, and they guide your decisions, and they guide your behavior. Being honest, we all will probably say if we're asked, we're honest. But you know what? We all are not. We're not all honest. We have excuses for why we don't tell the truth at times. We think we're being clever with facts and information when we're in difficult situations. Problem is when you're working with people and they need to trust you, if you've got a reputation for not always being a straight talker, for not always telling the truth, that compromises your trustworthiness and you're regarded as a person without integrity. Your credibility rating goes down and your ability to lead is compromised significantly. You know, there's a gentleman there who talks about honesty. Here's another guy who talks about integrity. Do you actually speak and behave in you know, is it complementary? The way that you behave, is it in line with the way that you talk? So we probably can all think of people we've worked with, some leaders in the past, who talked a good talk but didn't always behave the same way. That means they demonstrate a lack of integrity. So, you know, we've got examples here of a lot of the touchy-feely stuff. This last one, Mahatma Gandhi, you know, to him, ethical behavior was a must-have, even in the face of conflict from others or in a context where ethics become compromised due to all kinds of forces, social forces, or whatever. If you can stay focused on what's important and what's right, that's your values and that's your ethics guiding you. And what's the difference between ethics and values, by the way? I think I even have that on my next bullet point here. Ethics are universal truths around good behavior. So somebody can be ethical, and we all should be able to understand what we mean by that. They tell the truth. They behave with integrity. So ethical behavior is something that's universal that we all agree. It's kind of like the laws of the land, if you like, almost. This is what's acceptable. This is what's unacceptable. If you're unethical, you do things which everyone else would agree was not good or not right. So the ethics, you know, discussion is quite an easy discussion to have because we all understand what's right and what's wrong. If you tell the truth, if you falsify records, that's unethical, and we'd all agree on that. Values, though, values can be different. There's no right and wrong values. I mean, values could be in conflict with ethics. If your values are, you know, you like to rob banks, and that's what's important to you, and you believe you have the right to do that, well, you know, that's unethical behavior. Your values are in conflict with ethical behavior. That's a bit of a silly, extreme example I've given, by the way. What's more useful is just to think about how your values might be different from mine. And at the risk of offending some people, I know that whenever I talk about values with people and I try to get them to talk about what's important to them, sometimes we start to have really interesting, exciting arguments because some people really strongly believe in their values and they don't understand why everyone else doesn't have the same value. For example, you've got people who are great animal lovers. They love their pets. They're very protective of animals. They're advocates for, you know, the various organizations which protect animals. And of course, that's a good thing. For some others, that might not be the most important thing in their life. They've got other things which are higher up on their list of values. It doesn't mean they're bad people. It just means they have a different area of interest or focus. So hopefully I haven't, you know, given you the wrong idea here that, you know, I'm an animal hater. That's not what I'm saying. But if we have different values, guess how that comes across? in our day-to-day relations with others, they do influence how people view and judge us, because they just have a different way of looking at things. Think about politics, for example. Maybe that's a safer option. You might have different political views than someone else, and you probably respect the fact that people are allowed to have different views. You might not agree with them, but you respect that that's okay. It's not illegal. It's not unethical. It's just different. And that brings us on a little bit more to culture, which we'll talk about in a few minutes. You know, there's different cultures. It doesn't mean one's right and one's wrong. They're just different. So when we combine all of these things around honesty, values, integrity, trustworthiness, dependability, etc., we're actually, oops, there's my phone ringing. Can't answer that. We actually end up with a word called authenticity. You know, what is the, how authentic are we? When we're an authentic person, we're transparent, we're someone who demonstrates all of those qualities in a way which people can relate to and they can accept and trust. You'll be respected. You have a greater opportunity to be successful when you're regarded as an authentic person, even if your values are different from someone else's. My last point here, actually it says number one, number two, and number two. Well, that's a mistake, of course. I can't explain that. But number three, as it should say here, is an important point I want you to think about. If you're an authentic person, think about that Mahatma Gandhi example of doing what's right. Don't let policies and processes restrict you from doing the right thing. Policies are there to guide us, and they might be firm, interpreted as firm rules by some people or many people, but the world evolves, especially these days. Things are changing very fast, and we've got to be accepting that at some point in time, policies may need to be revised. Our process might need to change. That decision tree might need to be revised. So don't let policies or processes get in the way of doing the right thing. So next point is around a workable approach, and I'm talking here about being decisive and making sure we do making choices for getting things done. I love using examples of Winston Churchill. I get people make fun of me for this because I talk about Winston Churchill a lot. He talked about relevance. No matter how beautiful the strategy, you should occasionally look at the results. What he's really saying is what you're doing still relevant? And here's another example about setting goals. You know, and we've got JFK, who's very famously in a lot of leadership classes and books, this will be used as an example about how we get a leader who says, here's my vision and here's the objectives that I want you to do. Send a man to the moon by the end of the decade and bring him back safely to Earth. So it wasn't just a vision, it was a specific objective. Get him to the moon, do it by the end of the century, and make sure he comes back safely. So, you know, when we're talking about leaders making sure that they come up with a vision, thinking through to the mission and the objectives isn't something we always require a leader to do. But as a leader, you know, you have a right to start to qualify your vision that way too. So how relevant is the work that you're doing in IT service management? I already mentioned earlier, go and find out your business objectives. Think about where you can get this from. Come on, you know you can find this. If it's not on a notice board or in a presentation you had at the end of last year, it's got to be somewhere accessible. Ask around, you'll find this. Then start relating your ITSM goals to the business goals. Think about how your metrics can show that you're supporting the business objectives. And that allows you to then prioritize the work that you're doing, especially as it changes through the year. Empowering and inspiring action. Here we got Bill Gates, who said that this was a really important thing for the future. He talked about this a few years ago now. He was talking about the current century we're in now. As we look ahead, the leaders are the people who do the empowering, because we shouldn't be doing the work for each other. We should be empowering each other and help. What do we mean by that? I'll explain that in a moment. How do we empower each other? So we've got people working together towards some common goals. whether you're the designated leader telling people what to do and giving them the resources, or whether you're a coworker reminding and encouraging and advising and counseling your coworkers, we're empowering others when we give information. We're empowering others when we help them with some skills, give them access to tools, give them some funds, a budget, some time, some people, etc. So this is the one area I hinted at earlier where I said the designated leader has a bit of an advantage over the self-empowered leader. If you're a self-empowered leader trying to help a coworker, you can remind them of the vision and mission and objectives. That's knowledge. You can remind them of other pieces of knowledge and information that can help them, keep them focused, keep them on track, reassure them when they're unsure. You can maybe help them with some skills, show someone how to do something, point them in the right direction for how they can get the skills they need. Same thing with tools. Bit trickier to provide them with a budget. It's not always impossible. If you're working closely with a coworker, you may be able to help them to manage their way through a budget and reallocate funds. I mean, it's a bit of creativity in here, but you know, really, the budget is the one thing the designated leader has a lot more power and control over than the self-empowered leader. Also, when it comes to time and access to time and other people, the designated leader probably has, you know, more to offer here than the self-empowered coworker. But you know, if you're a self-empowered coworker, you can give your time, maybe the time of some of the people who work for you, to a coworker or an associate. So it's not impossible for the self-empowered leader to not provide any of these things, but it's just easier for the designated leader. This is the one area in my talk today where the designated leader does have more resources available. So think about this. You are empowering someone when you give any of these things. Empowering someone is not the boss just saying, I give you permission or approval to do something. That's just the very beginning. You also have to say, okay, here's the decision. I'm giving you the permission or the approval or the responsibility to do something, but you've got to back that up with time, people, budget, tools, knowledge, skills, etc. Otherwise, you're setting them up for potential failure. Everybody must be able to relate to examples where your boss has said, look, yeah, why don't you go ahead and do that, but make sure you still do your regular work as well. And by the way, there's no more money available. And really, they're asking you to do something, you know, and you've got to find your own resources and time to get this done. Depending on the example or the task at hand, you know, that might be a reasonable thing in some instances, but often it just shows a lack of understanding of what it means to really empower people. There is actually another element of empowerment, which isn't on this list, which is if you're the leader and you empower as a designated leader, if you empower a subordinate, not only do you have to make sure they have these things on this list, but you've also got to make yourself available as the work that proceeds, imagine it's a project, to help them as adjustments need to be made. You know, they need further advice. Maybe there's obstacles they uncover that they need your help with, you know, uncooperative team members and other areas of the business. A difficult supplier who's not responding. So, you know, if you've been given a job by your boss and you've suddenly found yourself up against a brick wall, you need to know you can go back to your boss to get further support. So, you know, let's make sure we understand what empowerment is. It isn't just waving a magic wand and saying to someone, I empower you. It's actually giving them what they need to get the job done. And, you know, that little quote at the bottom is a neat one because it really supports my messages about self-empowered leadership. Colin Powell said, you know, organization charts and fancy titles count for next to nothing. You know, we're looking to, it's all hands to the pump, sometimes in a time of crisis. And that's the context he often talks about from his background. But really, it can apply to us as well, is you don't have to be the person in charge in order to provide some leadership and to empower your coworkers. I mentioned culture earlier. You've got to be aware of the culture in your organization. What do we mean by that? Culture is all about the way people behave and relate to each other. You know, what's the dynamics around how people cooperate with each other, communicate with each other, support each other? How do they work together? And there's different types of culture. Let's think of a few business examples or a few examples. For example, well, we just talked about Colin Powell. What's the culture we have in the military or in the services, you know, or in the police force or, you know, the emergency services? Think about it. Lots of discipline, lots of rules, lots of ways of doing things. So things like respect for rules are strong. If you're in the military and you're a part of a team of people, everybody knows what their job is. There's a way that we get things done. There's a way that we behave towards each other. There's a way we treat each other. Respect for rules is really important. It can come in conflict. There can be tension between those respect for rules and the ability to be creative and innovative. So think about this. What type of organization do we see where there's not always the respect for rules you might see in a very tight-run ship, but there's a lot more creativity and innovation? We tend to see this in a lot of new businesses, especially, you know, like, you know, if it's not too passe to say .com anymore, but technology businesses, new creative. Think about some of the ways that we've heard about the way people work at organizations like Google and Apple and even Microsoft, Amazon. Hopefully they've got good rules for certain things that are important. And now we're getting into risk management when we think, you know, can we have such a thing as a healthy disrespect for rules? Does that make sense? Well, when do we break rules? When the risk's not high and the rewards are potentially great. In an organization that values and its culture, innovation and creativity, there's going to be tension against respect for rules. You know, I can think of examples of organizations I've spent time in where I've taught about best practice and I've tried to, and you know, in best practices and frameworks and standards, there tends to be more of a requirement for respect for rules, right? And the innovation sometimes has to suffer, and that's where we get tension in organizations where you're trying to roll out process and the need to stick to process and do things this way. It can come into conflict in some organizations where there's a strong innovative culture. So it doesn't mean one's right and one's wrong. It means you need to be aware of the culture, and therefore you have to plan your messages and your approaches and your strategy accordingly. The culture, as I say at the bottom, should never be a reason why something failed. If the culture is the reason why something failed as a project, it means we haven't taken into account the culture in the planning and in the execution. So think about the culture in your organization. We're talking about getting things done here on my fourth of my leadership characteristics, you know, empowering and inspiring action. Be aware, be self-aware of yourself, but be aware of the context of your organization and your teams so that the plans and the way that you communicate with people respect your knowledge of the way that they behave and the way that they work, what's important to us. This is actually, I don't really want to talk about this much. This is just a fun little quote about understanding power. Margaret Thatcher telling us about how, you know, if you've got to explain that you're the most important or that you're the leader, then it shows that you're actually not a good leader. It should come more from your behavior, the way that you behave and the image that you project. So in the area of communication, I've got a couple of examples here. One of them is, you know, John Lennon, self-empowered leader. Yeah, you could say he was the leader of the Beatles, but really that was more That wasn't something he was necessarily elected or appointed or promoted into. He is recognized by a lot of people, even so many years after his passing, as being a visionary and someone who had the ability to communicate and inspire. He is a fictional character, great Canadian Bill Shatner, in his role as Captain Kirk. Every episode of Star Trek began with this statement. If you were on the Starship Enterprise and you woke up and you wondered, why am I here? What am I doing? This kind of message would be ringing in your ears every morning. We're here to explore strange new worlds. They better be strange, because that's what we've been told to do. We've got to explore them. We've got to look for new life and new civilizations. And we're going to places nobody's ever been before. And, you know, how long are we doing this for? We're doing it for 5 years. Oh, really? And how are we supposed to go about doing this? We're supposed to do it boldly. So there's a lot of information here about what our vision is, what we're supposed to be doing. And it was very well clearly explained and communicated to us, the viewers. But I'm sure if you were on that mission, you knew this. This is what guided you every day when you were making your decisions. In fact, if you do a little bit of Googling on this subject and you find that the guy who founded Star Trek, Gene Roddenberry, he created a different statement in the writers in the first few episodes, trying to convince him that the vision statement and the mission statement, as this was, wasn't good enough. And it wasn't as clear, and it was a bit messy, and it got rewritten. It's quite an interesting thing to read, how you can come up with a vision and mission statement and refine it to make it have a higher impact and to strike at the heart of people and really get in their bloodstream. This mission statement does do that. The original Star Trek one didn't. If you want to search it, you'll find out. Hopefully you'll agree with me. So, communicating. When we're communicating as leaders in ITSM, we've got to be thinking about why we're doing things, what the benefits are, and you've got to keep re-explaining it. One of our heroes in leadership is Professor John Carter at the Harvard Business School, and he says leaders under-communicate by a factor of 100. That sounds like a huge kind of round number, 100. Maybe it isn't 100, maybe it's 92 or 86, I don't know. But the point he makes is he really stresses the point that we under-communicate tremendously. We tend to think that when you tell somebody something once, that's all you need to do. I told you, don't you remember a year ago when we were in that meeting and I told you this is what our vision was? Why have you made that decision instead of this decision? It's in conflict with our vision. If that's the only time you do communication once of important things like vision, mission, and objectives, then you're in a risky situation. You've got to be re-explaining, reconfirming, restating, hopefully not just like a broken record, reading the same thing and sending out the same email words, you know, frequently. You've got to be not just re-explaining it, but talking about it, asking people questions, looking for opportunities to bring this subject up again. So in discussions, in meetings, help people to make decisions by reminding them of our vision, mission, and objectives. So you don't have to be a broken record, you just have to be consistent in the way that you talk frequently about these subjects. So, you know, look for opportunities. You know, Winston Churchill says, you know, if you've got to be public speaking or speaking in front of a group of people, it is a very daunting thing to do. I know that. And in fact, as I said right at the beginning, you know, you could be good at all of the other characteristics, but if you're not strong in communicating, or you don't have a way to communicate well, or you haven't worked around your weaknesses in this area, then it's a great shame, because a lot of the good work and the good stuff we've talked about so far is going to fall on the stony ground. So, you know, you've got to put some effort into figuring out the right way to communicate your messages. Should it be written down? Should it be face-to-face? Should it be in phone calls? You know, what is the way that we communicate with people? And sometimes if it means getting everyone together, which it often does, so that there's a consistent delivery of important messages, then you've got to develop a skill there. You've got to get some practice, and you've got to learn how to talk to a group of people. That's more required of a designated leader. But even the self-empowered leader, speaking up in meetings is important. Last thing we want is people walking away from meetings and not making a full contribution. We need people to be more forthcoming and consistent. So look, in summary, I've said that anybody can be a leader, even if you don't have anyone to report to you. You know, you can support your coworkers, reminding them of the vision, being a trustworthy person who's authentic, who they can rely on, who's approachable, someone who knows what it means to empower, who helps people to get things done, the important things, of course, the relevant things, helps people to prioritize. And if you can also, you know, be a good communicator at the same time as all of that, then you can have a wider sphere of influence. And even if you're a self-empowered leader yet, and you maybe are at the early part of your career, if you can focus on these things, guess what? You get recognized for your leadership qualities, and it enhances your career prospects. You know, before you know it, you're appointed as a designated leader if that's your aspiration. I've got a little bit of information here on next steps for you, what you should be doing next as a result of this. If you're the designated leader, do that. Find out vision, mission, and objectives for your business. Think about how your ITSM organization can support and enable the business objectives. Get your group together and make sure you've got a complementary vision, mission, and objectives for your area. You know, whether it's the whole of ITSM or your team, who's a part of ITSM, and make sure people know this. And like Carter said, communicate it frequently, talk about it a lot, never stop. When I say never stop, it means you've got to make sure that as the business objectives change, I guarantee next year you'll have different objectives. Maybe the mission evolves. You've got to validate that what you're doing in ITSM is still in line. So never stop. If you're the self-empowered leader, it's basically the same thing, except you're not going to be gathering people together. You're going to do a bit more socializing, talking about it with your coworkers and people around you. And if you find that the vision, mission, and objectives for your area either don't exist or are out of sync with the business, look for opportunities to discuss this in more detail, and maybe, you know, talk to your boss about it, and not in a disruptive, troublemaking way, but use the opportunity to positively improve, you know, the vision, mission, and objectives for your team. So that's on that area. I've got more next steps. This is about empowering others. Make sure if you're the designated leader, you give people, you know, relevant objectives and expectations. And don't leave them high and dry. Understand what we mean by empowering. Make sure you give them the resources they need, and you keep checking in with them to offer your support and adjustment and counseling when plans need to change. Today, it's always a good idea if you can break projects into smaller pieces. It helps to keep people motivated and keep them on track, and it shows the value of the bigger project. We're actually getting something worthwhile as we progress through to the end goal. Always be prepared to make adjustments and reprioritize. That's the world we live in right now. As the self-empowered leader, you know, you can offer up your resources, your knowledge, your time, your help, your advice. And, you know, at the same time, don't hold back from asking your boss or people around you without being demanding, again, not without being a troublemaker, without being a difficult person to work with. You know, don't be shy in socializing the needs that you have to get your objectives met. And this, by the way, is my last slide. When we come down to the specific objectives and a further discussion here on relevancy, make sure that, you know, we verify that the things we're measuring, reporting on, and discussing aren't just there for curiosity and because they happen to be, you know, spewed out by the tools we're using. They're actually the metrics that directly support our objectives and our business. And look for improvements, improvements that are justified so that we can optimize our performance. We're not always looking to improve for the sake of it, only if it can be justified. So, you know, I'm asking you here to verify that the metrics and the measurements that you have in your ITSM organization and teams are relevant or helpful or directly in support of the business, and that they are used by you to directly drive improvements and enhancements that are valued. Again, don't do things just because you can. Don't look to improve or increase ratings or performance metrics just because you can. They've got to be relevant and they've got to make sense and be justified. As a self-empowered leader, again, you might not be directly responsible for this, but look for those. Look for those measurements and metrics and socialize and talk about them and try to encourage a dialogue and action to keep them on track and make them useful and relevant and help us to validate our purpose. That's it for me today. You know, we've been through these five characteristics. You can imagine if we were going to go through all 24, it would take a long, long time, take all day. But I think those five are a good five to get started. Hopefully after today, you know, we'll have an opportunity to talk again and go through some of the other characteristics or some of the other aspects of leadership and IT service management. I wish you well. What you can do is go to my blog, which is the stuff where it says blogs.pinkelephant.com/president. Don't do it right now because I haven't loaded up this file. I'm going to load up this file in a few minutes, and you'll be able to download all of these images that you've seen. If anybody had any questions or comments, I'd be happy to enhance my files and include something else in there if it's relevant. That's why I haven't got it up there right now, but I will do that, you know, right after this meeting here. So I don't see any more questions from anyone. So either that means, oh, Max is asking a question. Would you offer any quick win type of tips for leaders that are working in an environment where downsizing is occurring? All right. Would you offer any quick win type of tips for leaders that are working in an environment where downsizing is occurring? Well, I'm going to try and answer that as it relates to leadership rather than, you know, is this the right thing for your business to be doing? I mean, you are asking tips for leaders, so I think this is going to be relevant to you. So if you're working in an organization right now which is changing its strategy, which is what you're really saying, our vision in the business might still be the same, but our mission is possibly about to change because we're downsizing IT, or maybe we're outsizing. I don't know, maybe the vision is also changing as a result of downsizing. But the point is you're in a changing environment and you're looking for tips for what you can do when that's happening. So you're actually experiencing external forces that you need to react to. So many of us may well just think that, well, I just have to roll with this and I just have to react to this. And that's going to be true. There is an element of reaction. But if you want to be relevant and you want to protect your role or make sure that you are valued in the organization and you're not going to become a victim, then you've got to be understanding why this is happening. So what's the reason for this? How, and if it's unavoidable, which I guess it will be, then you've got to start asking and thinking about, how can you and your team support this downsizing? What can we do to make this as effective and efficient and as painless as possible. You know, there's an aspect of downsizing which is a bit sad, which is around things like people losing their jobs, etc., or something around you know, the business is shrinking or is under stress. I'm not sure if that's the case. It may well be. But, you know, I did work in an organization one time. I'll give you this example, where there wasn't so much a downsizing. There was a change in strategy, and the IT department was becoming defunct. We were distributed from a centralized mainframe to a distributed environment. And the team that I worked with were all given notice that over the next 2 years, we were working towards downsizing IT to the point where everything would be distributed. And actually, everyone's job was going to become redundant. What I did, and I don't know if this is much of a helpful tip for you, but it's my experience. I decided myself, maybe this is a bit irresponsible, but I benefited from it at the end, fortunately. I decided to stick to the bitter end. And what happened is, as gradually as people left and found other work, I took on more responsibility, learned more skills, and became very valuable to the organization, to the point where for the last few months, I was like the key person. If I suddenly didn't show up for work one day, the place ground to a halt. I'm not trying to be boastful here. I'm just trying to show you this was my experience. At the time, I remember thinking, I'm learning so much. I'm enhancing my resume. I'm going to be able to find work. And sure enough, I left on the day when everything closed down and the lights went off. And on the Friday and on Monday, I started as the IT manager in another organization that was on the upswing. I mean, I know I might not be being exceptionally helpful to you here, but I'm always of the view that you look for the opportunities. So if you've been downsized, look for why this is happening, what's needed from you and your team, so you can still show some value, you know, and let's see what good comes out of it. What else do we have? Any more comments or questions here? So thanks for that question, Max. I hope I've given you something to latch on to here. It's nice of you to say my tips are helpful. Thanks. Okay, Giorgio, actually, first of all, before I get to Giorgio, Ruben and Rich are asking, will the deck be posted somewhere on the Pink website later? As I mentioned, if you look at the last slide here, on my blog is where I always put all my presentations. I'm going to put it up there in a few minutes once I get off here. So don't worry, it'll be there. So Giorgio, what about ethics? There are people appointed to a position that don't perform well. Oh yeah, you're right there. How can you manage to deal with it from the real leader position? You know what? You're absolutely right, Giorgio. And you know, what we have to accept is unless you are the person at the very top of the pyramid, you can't control everything and you can't control who you work with. You can't control, you know, decisions that are made and who's appointed, but you do have influence. You do have influence, especially if you're well thought out, you follow some of the characteristic traits, capabilities I've talked about, and you're able to engage with coworkers and superiors, you can exercise influence. But at the end of the day, if you've got someone working in the senior position that you might be working for, it's their ethics that you have a problem with. The values are different, remember, but their ethics you have a problem with. It's time to go somewhere else. I know that's a dramatic statement, but you know, working in an unethical environment has got to be a big demotivator for the rest of us. So how do you deal with it? Well, exercise some influence if you think this is more of a lone wolf. Maybe exercise some patience as well, because chances are if this is not typical, that person probably isn't going to be around for very long. And I've got to be careful. I don't want to mention any names of companies, especially ones that we all recognize. But there are examples of ethical bad behavior in organizations which becomes part of the culture. Think of Enron, for example. I mean, I said I wasn't going to mention names, but I'm not saying every person working at Enron was unethical, but there was a disease across a tier of senior management of people not doing the right things, not behaving the right way, justifying their unethical behavior, you know, inappropriately. And there are other organizations who you could call it a question their corporate ethics, if you like. That's the type of business I would say you've got to get out of. You don't expect that to change overnight. An individual person may well be exposed, especially if they're fairly new, if there's someone who has managed to carve out a niche for themselves and they've been there for a long, long time, but their ethics are some, because of your closer working relationship, is something you find unacceptable. Maybe now it's up to you to figure out a way out for yourself. So, you know, I'm just trying to be realistic here. If it's a corporate ethical problem, you maybe shouldn't be there. If it's an individual, you've got to use your best judgment, think about what you want to do in the short and medium term. Are you going to ride it out, socialize the fact that this is unacceptable and look for more support and hopefully trigger a change? Or are you also going to just decide, you know, time to move on? What else have we got here? Any more questions? No. Nice of you to say nice comments here and there. I think we've got to the point now where we can get on with the rest of the work for the day. You've got other jobs to do. You've got other work to do. So let's move on and let's call it an end to today's session. Thanks so much for listening in and joining me. I hope what you've heard so far, there's some items here that you can follow up on. Look at the last three slides when you download them in a few minutes with the next steps and the tips on there. The most important thing you can do is validate what your business objectives are, because those can guide your decisions that you have to make every day. But be prepared to socialize with your coworkers, you know, what your purpose is as a team in supporting the business. Understand what it means to help your coworkers to be productive. And look for ways to enhance your capability to communicate within the team. You know, do these things and you'll be identified and recognized as a leader, regardless of your position. Okay, thanks very much. Hope to speak to you again very soon. Bye for now.